I'm Tom Yeomans. I welcome you all. Some of you danced as children in this barn. Some of you danced as adolescents. Some of you danced as adults. It's just wonderful that you came. And this idea came up last year talking to Gay. Wouldn't it be wonderful to have a meeting in the barn where so many of us danced in a period long gone when Westport was a different place, just to have some time to be together to reminisce about what it was like to dance in this space, and then also to talk some about what life was like at that time. Because there were many other activities that went on. This dance was one of the things, but there were nubble picnics, and there were charade parties, and there were sings, and there was a subculture of summer people who it was quite coherent. And those of us as children who grew up in it, it was really a very wonderful and unusual place to be as a child. As far as this barn goes, it was probably built in the 1850s by Otis Macumber, who was the farmer who owned this whole farm. And at that time, there were no trees. You could see the ocean from here. It was all grazed land. And Otis Macumber and his wife Priscilla, there's a memorial to Priscilla there from my grandfather, lived in a house right nearby. But the time I came along, it had been torn down. And they farmed this land, and they moved all these stones out of this land under to the walls. And there was Macumber's an old Westport family. In 1890, my grandfather showed up as a young man. He was blown off course in a catboat with his brother and didn't know where he was, and looked at the chart and said, well, here's this place called the Devil's Hole, which is another name for Westport. Let's get in there. And he and his brother, Charlie, sailed in and sailed in the catboat, which they'd chartered and paid Narum, to the end of the point, walked up the street, and was a nor'easter, so they had 3 days to stay here, and he fell in love with the place. And you can imagine what it was like in 1890. And that led to buying a field over there from Otis Macumber, in which he built a shanty, which eventually became a larger house once he married Julia, my grandmother, who was not going to live in a shanty. And then his unmarried sister, Mary, they built a house for her. And at some point, probably in the teens or 20s, this barn was converted from a hay barn to this loft. And there was also a shop built downstairs for my grandfather. And so I'm saying in the 20s, things began to happen here. And the things that happened were theatrical performances. And there's some photographs of early theatrical performances here. There were concerts. My grandparents were chamber music musicians. And so you'll see concert listings in the 20s and 30s that took place here. And dancing started. And Lyle and Polly Ring, who were musicians who taught at the Ojai Valley School, came. And this is the beginning of my memory. There was a piano up there. And I can't remember who called. Did Lyle call? Or Polly played and Lyle called, I think. Is that right? Lyle called, yeah. Yeah. And there was and the dancing was all English dancing, long ways dancing. And we were required to wear white. White shirts, white ducks, and white shoes. And it was very, it came right out of the English dancing tradition. And Lyle and Polly called during the 40s, maybe before, in the 30s and 30s and 40s. And then in the 50s, they stopped, and Dick and Beth Best, Dick played the guitar, and they came for a while. And the accordion?
Yeah.
Beth played the accordion. And this was a breakthrough. This we began to, oops, I'm in the wrong place again. We began to square dance as well as long waist dance. And there were conservatives who said, oh, this dance is going to ruin because we're doing square dances. And there were other people who thought square dances were wonderful. And so Dick and Beth helped with that transition. And then Ted Sannella showed up. And from that on, it was the dancing that many of us remember, everything, you know, from country dancing to Greek dancing. There's a wonderful Greek dance we used to do, and his spirit really infused this barn with energy, and it was wonderful coming here, and people will have memories of that time and before. And then in the late 50s, I believe, and we were talking about this, because a number of people have mentioned this, going downstairs to the shop and watching the floor move like this. it was decided that the barn, there's so many people were coming now. This was really a community event every Saturday night. There's so many people were coming that the barn was in danger, or the people in the barn were in danger. So it was moved to the fireside, and so this barn stopped holding the dances. But I think 59, yeah, because Duncan was saying he remembers dancing in the late 50s, and I think 59, I think by the 60s it was in the fireside. Yeah, the fireside, yeah. So that's a short history, and the only other thing that I will add, which is, well, it is wonderful that this space has survived. That's one thing. I just feel grateful that there's this degree of continuity. And in getting it ready, I had to clear a fair amount of things out of it. And I, you know, barns collect things that don't fit anywhere else. And then I said, well, you know, and Chip was talking about this the other day. He said, do you remember those runners that we used to put out on the benches? And Ted was reminding me that we used to have, these were new windows, and we had shutters that we would push out with sticks. But I remember those runners, and I said, yeah, Chip, not only do I remember them, I have them. And I found them in the trunk. And these runners were woven by Mabel Ball, who lived on Drift Road and kept goats. And I think she even had the goats in the house with her. She was a marvelous old woman with a beard. And she took the rags, and this was during the 30s. I think my grandmother must have commissioned her. Took rags and wove them into these runners. And every Saturday night, we would put these runners out. And here, 50-odd years later, maybe more, the runners are still here. So my sense is that somebody's memory will stir somebody else. So then if you get stirred, just come forward and talk, and in that way we'll build the memories.
Alan Chardon. My wife's Phoebe Chardon. She's out there somewhere. I can't see because of the lights.
By the way, were the most beautiful dancers I remember.
Well, my wife is... in any case, we were involved with the Ring Camp just before all of this started, and Lyle Ring had music up. I guess he just thought about music all the time. And so he really was, I think, one of the earliest areas for what we're sitting here for today, without any question. And of course, Fitches, needless to say, and a whole bunch of other people. But Phoebe and I were, I guess, when we first got here, in relation to really zeroing in on this particular building, was in relation to our fabulous square dancers and Lyle playing the piano and Best, was it Best that was here?
Yeah. Yeah.
Best later on. And it was just such fun. And it was a very relatively small group compared to what we've got right now. But it was really fun to have a local place down at the point where we could all gather together and have a good chance of dancing and kibitzing with each other.
I'm Ted Moore. A number of things I like to remember, and one is Tom's grandmother, Julia, on a moonlit night in July or August, she'd come drifting across the meadow in her chiffons with a great white brimmed hat on. And this was very impressive to someone about 8 years old, 9 years old. And that was quite a while ago. And on top of that, Tom's grandfather had a shop downstairs. And on rainy, he used to build boats. And he tried to encourage Hugh Lawrence and Bob Wicks and myself to come and build boats on rainy days. We did this several times. And things just led on to square dancing every Saturday night. And Emily Harris used to play the piano, too, along with Aunt Polly Ring. And Lyle would call the long ways for as many as will, or the black nag, or Selinger's round, or what was the other? Oh, the old mole, and the circular hay. But all these things were wonderful memories, and what a life it was in Westport in those days. On rainy days, I don't know what we did, but we managed to have a good time. And over by the door, there used to be a New Yorker cartoon. I don't know whatever happened to it. It was about the day the cake of soap sank at Procter & Gamble. And it was a wonderful cartoon. I'll always remember it. A great swimming pool with just rings, you know, and all these old stuffers wandering around looking very concerned. But these were wonderful times in Westport, and we owe so much to the Yeomans for donating all this and sharing it with all the people, that were many of us who were here so many years ago. And it also led, you know, to Putney School in Vermont, which Tom's grandfather helped start, and I think he had a house there for many years. He doesn't have it anymore. It's not in the family anymore, is it, Tom? But those things led to all sorts of good things. The Zanzigs were here, and Gus Zanzig, who put together Singing America, I think it was, and... well, yeah, Home and Community, the red book or the white one. I'm not sure which one. But they were both. But anyway, and then we used to sing here occasionally on Sunday afternoons. And these were all good things. And Lyle was such a part of it all. And Emily Harris. And there was another lady by the name of Betty Beware. And she... Yeah, we call her Betty Beware. But she was a violin teacher, and she tried to teach me to play violin. But it was at the wrong time in my life. My voice was changing, and that didn't go very well with the violin.
She was a very powerful presence. I love that image of her sweeping across. And but what she tried to do to me, which was a real issue in the family, was there was a certain age where you had to go home and not stay. You know, the kids would dance, and then at 9 o'clock, you know, at age whatever. And I kept approaching that age, and she moved it up another year. This happened several times, and then finally my parents said, this is enough, and they would sneak me out and get me over here and so forth. But she was a powerful presence, and she did sustain this dance long after my grandfather died, and it kept it going. So her spirit is here too, definitely.
I'm Chip Gillespie. Tom reminded me of something, as he was hoping we would do, about something that I'd completely forgotten about. When I was a kid, my mother took me to Mabel Ball's house for some errand, and I remember to this day being shocked going into her kitchen and seeing four or five goats, one of which was on a mantelpiece. And the smell of that kitchen, I'll never forget that. But anyway, I danced here as a young teenager in the 50s, and loved this. And back in those days, Saturday was the most special day of the week, even as a kid, because the routine, and I grew up next door on the Wicks Hill, was that on the morning you'd get up and you'd see if it was good enough to go sailing, you'd have a swim down at the river, you'd go to the beach before lunch, and you'd go sailing all afternoon, and everybody looked forward to coming to the dance on Saturday night here. And, you know, being 14 years old at this dance, that experience was colored by all sorts of social angst and who was dancing with whom and will I get to dance with Carly Coolidge and you know, and admiring all those older, fabulous dancers that I always wanted to be as good as. But one of the wonderful things about it was the various... you're older than me, Alan. But I want to talk about the dances just a little bit. I mean, everybody could square dance, and that was great, and we all love square dancing. But there was sort of a hierarchy of the different dances that, as a kid, you sort of aspired to. And the first was to learn the Row to the Aisle so that you could get out there and go around there with everybody. Some special little dance, still like it. And the other thing was contra dancing was a little harder than square dancing, but equally as fun. But the top of the heap was the Black Nag, and on top of that, Newcastle, and on top of that, the Old Mole. And man, if you could learn those, you were there. And we still do the Black Nag down here. Unfortunately, we don't do Newcastle, which was my favorite. English square dances, I guess you'd call them. And the Old Mole, which was very complicated and intricate. And half of these guys here knew how to do that, and I always envied that. But this is always a very special place. And square dancing continues to be an important part of this community, but back then it was much more focused this is the only place you wanted to be on a Saturday night. And I'm sure lots of people have other stories about that, but I will always remember this barn.
I'm Bea Brewster, also known as Betsy. Everyone's talking about the wonderful old English dances and the square dances. And there were square dances that we could sing all the words to, because we knew at certain words we were supposed to be in certain positions, and so on. But no one has mentioned my favorite dance of all, which was a Swedish dance called Weave the Wadmal. And it was very picturesque of weaving. There were points where you all linked elbows and squashed the material together. There were points where you went around in a circle, heaven knows why. And Lyle Ring taught it patiently every year, so we all knew what we were doing, and Alan and Phoebe led the dance and went down at one point and hit everybody on the head. I've never figured that one out either. Lyle Ring was such an inspiration. He not only played for the dances and changed keys in the middle of things, but he led the sings as well, so that we'd gather here or at the Ring's house and spend an afternoon or an evening singing our hearts out of Home and Community, Songbook, the Singing America, the Concord series. And we had the most wonderful time. So many of us were just coming to appreciate choral, classical music, and it was a revelation. It was really very exciting. It's impossible to tell about everything, so I'll hand it back.
My name is Ann Fenn, and after the discussion of my grandfather and my grandmother, I felt I needed to be here to represent them, as well as my mother, Nancy Fenn, and my uncle, Alton, and Ed Yeomans, because Ed Yeomans was key to my grandparents coming here. He was really crucial, and they were such close friends. I guess for me, the Saturday night square dance sort of represent Westport for us, and continue to actually for my family. My brothers come down, and their nieces and all come down, and everybody's very excited about Saturday night, and we still prepare for it. When Chip was talking about Saturdays and getting ready, I mean, you'd lay out your clothes, you know, you'd figure out what makeup and, you know, jewelry and everything you're going to wear, and who's going to be there and who wasn't going to be there. I mean, as a teenager, it was definitely the highlight of the week. My grandparents often talked about all the time, talked about music, and as you know, there were a number of pianos in our house, and everybody in the house played something, from my mom to my aunt playing the violin. And there was quite a bit of pressure on us as the younger generation, because we, you know, if we danced a little too fast, if we swung too fast, I mean, my mom would say, "Ann, lean back, just take teeny steps. This is supposed to be graceful. You're not supposed to be racing around the floor here." So there was a certain standard that we were supposed to make sure that we came up to. We always heard about the barn, but I'd never been here. This is the first time that I've been in this barn, actually, on this property. I've never... but I've always heard about it all my life. For the sings, I remember the sings because we got very excited. We'd clean out the living room and set up the chairs in our house. And my grandparents would both sing. I think lots of times my grandfather's given a lot of credit for the music, whereas my grandmother also was actually very musical. And I remember your father talking at her funeral about the bells on her toes, you know, and recounting that. For us, Fireside was the place where we were going, and Ted Sannella was really key to that, and I think the person who now replaces him, sometimes I think I hear Ted Sannella when I hear the gentleman now who, I can't remember his name, but Dan does it, but every now and then when I hear Dan talking, it sounds like Ted. I think that's all I have to say. But it's just that music and square dance is just an integral part of Westport for us, and we really in our family try to make sure that those feelings and the excitement, and I'm not sure our standards are quite as high as my grandparents would like. I don't really say to my daughter, Danielle, you need to swing a little slower. It's more just get out there and have a good time. But I definitely wanted to come here and represent them.
I'm Dan Fitch. My memories of Westport growing up here as a summer person over 70 years ago is that we were involved in a lot of innocent fun. And I look around this room and I see many of my teenage colleagues sitting around, and we had a great time, and we never really got in trouble, did we? And part of our fun at Westport was to look forward to what I remember being called folk dancing, never square dancing. I think it was folk dancing that we called it. And as Tom and others have said, getting ready on Saturday for the excitement that was going to occur Saturday night was part of that innocent fun. We'd go over to the beach and watch the submarine races, and you know what I mean when I say that. This was World War II, the submarine races, and we would be planning what to wear that evening. After the dance, and I do remember the rings being on the stage, very much in charge, very much being certain that there was no fooling around, you did it as you were directed, and you had fun doing it that way. And after the dance, by the way, we always walked. We never drove. Cars were not available in World War II, and even a little bit before that. There were fewer cars than today, certainly. We walked here, and we walked back, but we always walked home via Harry Soles. Remember that? For our sodas, because we were each given a nickel as we left home to come to walk to the folk dance and walk back to Harry Soles, and he would stay open just to get the traffic from the folk dance to buy their nickel Cokes. We had a great time growing up, and I feel sorry for the next generations. I really do.
You know, just the post-dance activities, which was also part of it. I remember going swimming at the beach after dancing.
Skinny dipping.
Well, I wasn't going to say it, but yeah. That was a little edgy for the 50s. And we also would sometimes go sailing. And particularly in the full moon, I remember dancing and then going down and getting on the amberjack and sailing out to sea under the full moon with this dance inside. So there was this medley of and people were mentioning the beach, the dancing, sailing. We all had little boats that we could sail up the West River and the East River together. And it was this wonderful, what I was saying in the beginning, there was this rich, larger dance that was going on among the children and the adults at this time, during this time, which is quite wonderful.
Yeah. I'm Barbara Kanitzer. I started here at the folk dancing probably the late 30s, early 40s. And as they have said, then it was definitely folk dancing. And it was always the highlight of our life, and with my children as well. All Saturday it was planned. that would be the big excitement of Saturday night. Excuse me. I will go back a little earlier in my memory to the problems we had here at the barn when the floor began to weave up and down, and I'll have to check with the Chardons about this, but as I recall, Clifford Ashley was called in to check the underpinnings of the barn to see if they needed to be shored up in any way so the dances could continue here for a few more years. And then, excuse me, after that we went to the fireside. The surprising thing was that after we went back to school in September, in my children's generation, they would be recounting tales of the summer with their friends, even during high school years. And the friends were just aghast when the highlight of my children's summer was to spend Saturday night folk dancing. It just wasn't the thing that the young people in the city would do on a Saturday night. So we've been really disturbed in recent years with my grandchildren, excuse me, to find there are influences that are saying, oh, it's not the cool thing to do. So I think we all have to use our influence to encourage them to stay with it and make sure that it continues as the wonderful tradition that it always has been.
That light is bright. I'm Kathy Preston, was Kathy Hall, and I'm one of the ones who started dancing here, like Barbara, probably late. I'm 78 now. I think I was probably seven, eight, when I started coming to those wonderful folk dances. I was sitting there trying to think of some of the dances. Certainly there was Gathering Peace Cods and Old Mole, but also if all the world, what is that? Paper and all the seas were ink, if all trees were bread and cheese, what we have to do, yeah, right. And Picking Up Pawpaws, remember that one? Put them in your pocket. And we all learned to do the haze, and it certainly was the highlight. And I lived way down on the West River, and I can still remember, and I don't know why my family let me do this, but I had to walk up here to the dance, and I... No, I don't, do they? I don't remember that. Oh, well. Really? But I remember having to go down to the, walk back down to my house on the river in pitch black, scared to death, but nothing would keep me from these dances and the sings, which I have to say were, I ended up teaching music for a few years, and I have to credit everything I have to Lyle and Polly. They were my inspiration.
How many people remember the water cooler? It was out at the end of this porch, and Lisa, my cousin, who would love to have been here, that's what she remembered. It was a tall green kind of thermos with a little thing and tiny little Dixie cups about this big. And everyone would go out and crowd on that porch there trying to get these little cups of water. And
I'm Jerry Zetzel, and I represent sort of the next wave. We didn't grow up here. My husband and I came here because of the Yeomans. I was a teacher with Ed at Shady Hill School, which also had a big tradition of folk singing and folk dancing, which still continues to some extent today. And we started coming here, my husband and I, Arthur Kohlenberg, with our two little kids in the late 50s. And really, it was a wonderful example of a community that was welcoming enough to really accept and acculturate these outsiders. I think we and the Tuckers were the first Jewish families here. The Tuckers, I don't believe, went in for folk dancing, as I remember, they didn't. But music, yes. And it was a great place for our kids. We bought a house eventually across the road at 1770, which we still have, that my son, Andrew Max, has. And it was a community that was really a wonderful place, a very simple but very rich place for a young family to come in the summers. And eventually we came a lot on weekends in the winters. Before I finish, I want to tell one Julia story. two Julia stories. One was when we first were here, Ed and Jean had just moved into the big house, and Julia would come by and come in and take tea and say things like this to Jean as she left. I don't think those curtains are hung the way they should be. but the other memory is being down at the boatyard fishing or fooling around on the boatyard beach and hearing Mrs. Tripp on the loudspeaker Ed would be out doing something on the amberjack at the mooring, and she would yell, "Ed Yeomans, you call your mother."
John Spicer, across the river, I'm the new generation too, who was acculturated into the Point because I met my future wife here in this barn. I was living on Old Harbor Road, working on my dad's summer farm on the Old Harbor Road. We were called hillbillies by the harbor people because we wore the old clothes that allowed us to work and sail in the afternoon. Work in the morning, sail in the afternoon. We noticed that the Kalmar used to go out of the river passing us just as we were about to leave mooring of our own at the harbor with... And sometimes would try to race them coming back in, but they always won. I didn't realize my wife was on board that boat. But I was invited to come to a barn dance, not a square dance or a folk dance, at the Yeoman's Barn. And I was double dating with a guy called, well, Newell Robb. Is Newell here? Newell here? Newell said there were a couple of cousins he were dating us with, and I was matched with Kathy Hall, and Newell with Targy Wicks. And halfway through the evening, I realized what a lively dancer Targy was, and so I managed to dance with her, and Newell and I switched halfway through the evening. But then something called the Old Mole came up, and Targ advised me that it might be best if she danced with Ted Moore on that one. You see, my own preparation had been to recorded square dances in a lodge over in South County, Rhode Island, Pawsococo Lodge, through the Appalachian Mountain Club, where we tried to get instructions as to what we were doing, and I was shoved around, and I thought my corner was over there, that corner of the room, rather than being a real person. So I was still learning, and Lyle put me straight very quickly, and then Dick Best, who, since Targ and I married that first year and went abroad, when we came back, it was Dick Best who was leading the crew here, and shortly after, we did notice the floor going up and down. And so I guess I joined the square dance committee that moved us around to various places. But I do remember the camaraderie of this place. I don't think it's been replaced in any other square dance or folk dancing milieu that I've been in.
I have just a small story about your grandmother. Julia was always the queen of Westport. And one night we danced a dance and she sat right over there watching. When it was all over, Julia got up and clapped and she said, "Well, good done."
I'm Selena Howard. And yes, a relative newcomer to Westport. We bought our property and built our house in 1952. We came as Dave Wicks and my husband Jim were young Turks at the Lawrenceville School in the history department, and they were very close, and Dave and Connie urged us to come here in the summer because we had no other place to go. And Dave found our property on the Cornell Road, which, if you'd seen it then, you'd wonder how in the world we ever decided to buy it. But we were, as has been said before, acculturated into this wonderful community, most of which, or many of which, were all school teachers. And this has been a very, very much an academic group as well as a musical group, and it was great. We came with our four kids, or we didn't have four then, but we had four kids, and it was just the greatest place to be. And we've been here permanently since 1976.
One of the things that was so exciting about this place was that you not only did the singing and the dancing, but it was taken seriously, which meant not only are the dances and the singing important, but the people who did them were as important. When you sang Jesu Joy of Man's Desiring or danced the old mole, it was because they showed you how to do it and you could do it. It was a wonderful kind of seriousness.
Barbara Wicks, Bob Wicks' wife, and Targ's sister-in-law. And when I have to tell you that when I came in today, Targ said, looked around and said, I thought there'd be a lot of old dodderers here. I said, Targ, we are the old dodderers. So. I was brought here by my mother when I was 6 months old, but I don't remember that. And then I remember dancing first in 1940 when I was 11 here. And I just wanted to refer back to something, some words that Betsy and also Tom used about the experience of the culture of the music and the dancing and the sings, and those were formative things for me, absolutely. Lately I've been thinking back on what are the things that have made me and that I've loved more in my life than anything else, that have been more enriching, and certainly they all started here in this barn and down in the Rings living room. Thank you.
I think for my grandparents and my mom and my dad, I could sort of hear my mother saying, and you better get back up there and say this, for them, a sense of beauty was the music, the outdoors, the simplicity of Westport. And we were always taught to really appreciate and understand and look for real beauty. And I think for me, even though we have now, my family's done a lot of traveling, and recently we took a big trip. One of my brothers turned to me in the south of France on the Mediterranean and said, oh, isn't this gorgeous? You know, this is absolutely beautiful. And I said, yeah, this is beautiful, but it's not as beautiful as Westport. Westport's the most beautiful place in the world, and it will always be the most beautiful place in the world for me.
Julia, I remember her as a little kid on the beach, but Jean was my idol. She was so beautiful, and she wore wonderful clothes, and walked down the beach in her bare feet with a beautiful skirt, and sometimes a hat, I think. Anyway, she was my idol.
Gay newcomer. You may remember my ex-husband, Sam. He was rather charismatic at the square dances, very tall. But we started coming here because of Fred and Holly Locke, who I don't think are here. And that's a Shady Hill connection. We were living in Providence at the time. And we ended up having five children, four of whom were the same ages as the Lascaris children, Judy's family. And they had wonderful times together at the square dance and in the evening and at the Olivers. And I see Amy is here. And it was just wonderful for our children. And square dancing was really the highlight, not only for them, but also for me and Sam. I wonder how many people aren't here that we remember from a square dance that we might mention, perhaps. I'm trying to think of. But I was wondering where Prill is. Yeah, yeah. Oh. Oh, that's a shame.
Jay Bonner was one of the best dancers we had. A bit of a wild one. He would certainly swing us right off of our feet. But he went on to do a lot of English dancing with his wife before he died. He was great.
I wanted to make a comment, which was that there are a lot of people we knew who had met at square dancing and subsequently married. And I noticed over the years that some of those people couldn't come to square dance anymore. They would come and bring their children for the earlier part and then go home and take care of the children. And I think that's one of the reasons, perhaps, that the adult square dance hasn't had as many people, which was too bad, I thought. But on the other hand, wonderful marriages.
I'm Tacy Kohlenberg. What? I wasn't going to come forward because I was too young to dance in this barn, but I'll tell a barn story and a dance story. The barn story is about a summer, I want to say maybe the summer of 1960, when all it did was rain. It just rained and rained and rained, and there were a lot of us children who were driving our parents completely bats. And we had a babysitter that year. I think it was Andrea, who became eventually my aunt. But it was somebody who took us and the Brewster kids, and I forget who else, and we put on a production of, was it you? It was my mother. A production of Winnie the Pooh on that stage behind where you're sitting. And there are still some photographs of that. I was Pooh. Chris Brewster was Roo, and anybody who knows Chris Brewster will recognize the appropriateness of that assignment. And it was a wonder, I mean, the smell of the barn for me is so vivid. Just walking in here today, there's something, I don't know what it is, but this barn has a very particular smell. And I think it is in, there have been art classes here and spiritual sittings and all sorts of things over the years that have impressed themselves on the wood around us and are here with us and keep us warm. So that's a barn story. And about the dance, I'm of that younger generation. There's another one of us over there who may come and speak, who were really a fireside dancers. When I think the dance was bigger at the fireside than it ever could be here. It was equally the center of our lives, and I remember driving in our old VW bus, which we brought home from Europe, driving through the fog on Drift Road to get to Fireside. And that sense of sort of expectation and excitement and mystery as we parked and walked into the eaves of that, what I remember is quite a long and low building, and Ted's calling, which was incredible. And Ted, I don't think we knew growing up that we had one of the great callers calling for us. It was just Ted, and Ted was part of Westport and Summer. But he was an extraordinary caller, and like all very good callers, could get a little testy when the youth got a bit too silly or loud. And I'm just wondering how many people remember the way he would speak at those moments. I remember some of the silly dances that we did, and the one that Gay and I sometimes danced together. What is that? Salty Dog Rag, thank you. Not an English dance at all. Right, well, that actually was not my generation. But I think thinking about the dance and how you bring in and keep the young people now, one has to have silliness and a little bit of wildness to keep it going. I remember skinny dipping after the dances, and it's all mixed in with the Nubble picnics that Tom mentioned earlier, that sailing over in the evening and then sailing back in the dark and sometimes missing your way, misjudging the tide and discovering that the breakwater was actually to port instead of to starboard. And I think the other part, I was too young for the Lyle Ring, Lyle and Polly Sings, but were long dinners in the big house across the field, lobster and corn, and the children spinning off into the night to play games in the dark while the adults talked and talked and talked by kerosene lantern about all sorts of things that were as yet not our concerns.
Hi, I'm Phoebe Ashley, and now for 56 years, Phoebe Chardon. One of the things that I've always remembered that Ted said to me once and amused me with was, Westport Point is the only place I come every year and start again at square one. Oh, dear. And he was close to Alan's my age, well, a number of us close to our age, and somehow we talked him into coming here after Saturday night on Sunday mornings and teaching us more complicated dances because he was always at square one at otherwise. And we had a couple of triplets, and I was trying to remember who was involved, Alan and I and Christine, and Christopher Loring was, but I'm not sure. We had either one or two triplets. Who else was? But it was such fun, and we came at 8 o'clock in the morning and danced for a couple of hours, and I thought, wow, Ted, after working the way you did last night, you're just wonderful to come and do that with us in the morning. And he really was the most marvelous man, and he gave us so many years of such fun. It seemed that there were many more women than men. And so during the interim between dances, there was always a good deal of jockeying around for partners. And you'd either sit in a line here waiting patiently or go out and circulate on the porch. And I remember from my early teens thinking that Kathy Preston and, Kathy Hall and Targ Wicks were two of the most wonderful people in the whole world, and I'd love to have them as my friends. And so, of course, I'd always go out and try to talk to them. And I'm several years younger, and I was always impressed because they were always so terribly welcoming and nice to the little squirt that was coming around to them. But that was true of everything. I felt everybody here was welcoming and friendly and fun. I did have one more thing to say, which has popped right out of my mind. It was really, I know what I was going to say. Last night I got out, I've been keeping a line of day diary since 1943, and I got them out last night and looked at Saturday nights, and indeed we were folk dancing every single time, said going to the folk dance. And I never wrote barn dance, it was always folk dance. But it was really obvious from reading through these little things that I wrote that I was having the most wonderful time. And this is the way both Alan and I always remember this barn.
The teenager, and there was this kind of looking up to the older ones. And Denny Shannon was a wonderful dancer. And Chris Loring also. Is Denny here? Denny, come talk about it.
I think one of the things that I remember best was that there were two sets of six dancers. Allison, Ian Lascaris, Chris, I dance with Chris a lot, Phoebe and Alan danced together, but there were two sets of six who memorized all these English dances. We didn't have to have them called. And we would just take the floor and they'd start the music and off we go. And we were very, very good.
I think of Phoebe, too, as someone who's just extraordinarily beautiful, and the two of you dancing together. So this quality of beauty, wonderful to remind that, because I think in some ways that is something that underlies a lot of the sensibility that was being expressed in these different ways. And also I think it's interesting in terms of see how this evolved, is there was something about standards, and I love this word seriousness, and that we were drawn into the seriousness, and it gave us joy. It was a very interesting combination of accepting the discipline that the elders insisted on, at the same time, the joy that was released in the dancing is quite a wonderful combination, and that seems to be a theme that's moving through here. Yeah.
And there was wonderful satisfaction in dancing well rather than being wild and remembering how to do the complicated ones. I just had a quick story about Ted. Phoebe reminded me about his patience. And when he came here in the summers, he had to start over virtually every year. And the worst part was the first dance of the month, because all of the summer people were coming in and wanted to socialize the whole time. And he somehow corralled everybody into dancing eventually. And I just never understood why he put up with us for all those years. But the other thing about Ted is, over all those years and all those summers of dancing, we sort of monitored the development of his life. When Gene came and he got married, and then when the kids came, and then when the kids had kids, they were all ended up at the square dance. And we sort of watched Ted's outside life develop in front of us. And it was pretty neat. And it's also pretty neat to have Dan Pearl, which is kind of the next Ted Sannella, almost literally. It's great.
I'm Amy Scott, and I am a real newcomer. I didn't get here till 1969, but I've been here very much ever since then. And I have many other connections with the barn. I've painted here one summer. I taught modern dance and art classes to 35 kids in this room. That was in 1970. So different, ongoing, very wonderful memories and associations with this building. This is some notes from Janet Breslau, Ted's daughter, that I've been asked to read. I have many fond memories of the Westport dances, including picnic dinners at a highway rest stop on the way there, and the combined thrill and embarrassment of helping Dad with demonstrations. But I also have a few not-so-nice memories, like when my older siblings would tell me spooky stories about the cemetery across the street, and the times when my dad would invite me along, quote, to help keep him awake on the way home, which made me paranoid that I drifted off to sleep and we got in an accident, it would all be my fault. What was the age cutoff? Wasn't it something you had to be 10 years old before you were allowed to dance? I recall someone telling me this years ago, but can't remember the details. Well, there was a kids' dance at the beginning that always ended with the grand march, then the adult dancing. I don't remember an age limit per se, but there may have been. I do remember watching a lot, and then when I was older, I was able to jump right in because I'd studied it so long and so well.
I think I have just a few words to say as maybe one of the younger members of this group today. I'm Amazal. My house is across the street. But when I was growing up, I lived down on the Point. I was a year-round resident of the Point, and so we looked forward to the coming of the summer folk with great pleasure, because that was the only other time that I had kids my age around, except for Chip and Gay's kids, who were also my age. But Tom's two sons were great friends of mine, and I spent quite a lot of time here in this barn, not dancing, but putting on plays with Peter and Ben and our friends the Roberts, and many long summer nights playing Ogre and having dinner in the big house, in the dark house, and playing Murder in the Dark, I think, was another one that we played. But Saturday nights were always for the square dance, and my earliest memories of the square dance were of falling asleep at the square dance. When I was about two or three, my parents would put me to sleep while the grown-ups got dancing. We didn't have babysitters in those days, and so I just slept, you know, on the benches besides. But quite soon thereafter, my mother started advocating or trying to get me in under the age limit so that I could start dancing. She was quite sure that I could dance even though I wasn't four or five or whatever it was that you had to be in order to get into the kids' dance. And so I started dancing and danced every night, every Saturday night, until I was in my teens and was doing that less. But I do have very fond memories of watching the older dancers. I particularly remember John and Targ dancing the Salty Dog Rag and watching people and trying to pick up steps to the different, more difficult dances. And I have wonderful memories of many, if not all of you here, teaching those of us who were coming up behind you to dance. And so I think I'm, I don't you know, I don't know how active the dances are these days, but they were a very, very big part of my childhood, and we often ended up skinny dipping at the beach afterwards, and it was a wonderful time, and still a very strong community of young and old in the same space, sharing an evening of dancing together.
I'm Gay Gillespie, and I can't even imagine a summer without square dancing. I think I grew up in diapers from Baker's Beach, and I've really missed square dancing, and I have a confession. We haven't done a lot of it recently, and it's mostly because we've got grandchildren, and the babysitter thing has been sort of an issue for us. But I wanted just to follow up on Amma. Her mom, Kate Zoll, was a beautiful dancer. And after the fall one year, she decided that we would have a winter series down here, and she brought one of the best dancers, who's almost too strict for me, but he sort of would teach us that you want to pretend that you're a fly on the ceiling and you want to watch yourselves pirouette around, and you could actually picture yourselves as butterflies dancing and doing your corners and your swings. And that was Michael Ciccone, and I think he's actually quite well known in the dance world and has done quite a few recordings with some other folk singers that I really love their music. But with the beautiful dancers, it was the older group that I remember most as teenagers that were the, Alan and Phoebe. I remember hearing stories that you met there, you were high school sweethearts through it all and got married, and here you were. And I always really aspired to the fact that, you know, you started there. And I met Chip, I can't even tell you how many years ago now, 37 years, honey, over there. And one of the things I loved about him was he's one of the best swingers I've ever had as a partner swinging. And I think that's an important function, is to be able to be a good swinger. And then when somebody tells you you're a good swinger, I think you've really made it in the square dance world. But that Saturday nights as a teenager, it was really the night of the week. And somebody said earlier, you'd put your clothes out and you make this top with that top. You talk to all the other girls on the beach. Do you remember the Tompkins girls and Dunlap girls who were down here? And Annie Lawrence was my big, my best buddy there, and Punky Brewster, and Lida. We would all sort of be at the beach and talk about what we were going to wear that night, and then we'd get to the dance, and you'd sit there hoping you weren't going to be one of the wallflowers, and one by one you'd get peeled off with either one of the Paul boys or one of the Frisches or the Allens, and I mean, there was just a whole order of socialization that happened around the square dance that was so, it was just our lives. It was forever our lives.
This one is really just, has nothing to do with Ted Sannella or anything, but I think it's one of the last times I danced, and I have no idea who the caller was, but he said I was a wonderful dancer, and he wanted to do the waltz with me, and I have always seen those pictures of the people waltzing around with their great dresses and so forth, and I was so thrilled, and I'd never danced with anybody who waltzed the way that man waltzed, and we went around and around and around, and when it was over, I went flat on my face on the floor.
That seems like a good note to end on. So, this has been wonderful, and I so appreciate you coming and creating a living history, really. And those of you who didn't speak, your presence here enhanced what happened. It's not some of us spoke, some listened, but it's really what we created together as a community of memories, of reminiscences, of focused here in the dancing, but also the other aspects of life at that time, how these traditions have gone on. And, you know, we and our children and our children's children are the bearers of those traditions now in a world that's changed tremendously. And Westport has changed tremendously. But there is a core of something here that people have spoken to that is ageless. And it's our pleasure and our privilege and our responsibility to keep sustaining it in ways that are right for each of us.